This is a float valve, and if you have an overhead water storage tank like ours, installing this will make your life so much easier because it can stop overflow for good and you won't need a ladder ever again. I'll explain why and I'll show you how in a bit. Hey there, this is HanDIYman 007, and if we're just meeting for the first time, hello! And my passion is building, fixing, and improving all sorts of stuff at home for my family and sharing with you what I have learned from experience and from others. For the longest time, we have endured with this setup where every time we needed to store water, we had to climb a ladder up and down just to reach and turn on a faucet and do it again to turn it off. And yeah, there were many times we had overflows because we were too busy doing something else to monitor the rising water level from start to finish. So today, we're going to do something about that by replacing this hideous faucet with this float valve I purchased online, which will serve as our automatic water level controller. You basically have an inlet here where water comes in and flows out to the spout. And you have a plastic ball here, in this case a cylinder, that's filled with air. It is attached to an arm that has a valve on the other end which opens or seals the spout depending on the angle of the arm. As you already know, gas is lighter than liquid, so the idea is, as water rises, it pushes the ball and the air inside it upwards, and in turn, moves the valve on the other end to slowly seal the spout shut. Conversely, whenever we consume from this tank and water goes downwards, the ball also goes down, opening the valve and once again adding in more water. It also comes with a pivot point with a wing nut. Loosen the nut to adjust the arm to a desired angle, which will control how much water it will allow in before it completely seals the spout. If you want to go high-tech, there are also electric float switches sold out there, but personally, I prefer float valves because they are mechanical, simple to install, and obviously don't require any constant power source and wiring. As much as possible, I like to keep my water and electricity far apart. So watch all the way to the end of this video where I show you this float valve in action and where you can get one. Meantime, let's go back and see what else we need. Ah, see this part here where the pipeline arches over and into the tank? I need that to be shorter, almost hugging the brim as much as possible, so when I connect the float valve, it will be at least 2 inches below the brim. This is in preparation for a related project where I'll build a lid or cover for this tank to prevent dirt and insects from contaminating our water storage. Anyway, it's easier to cut that entire section and build a new one with these PVC elbow joints with half-inch holes, or known in the plumbing world as bores. I need 2 of this type, which has a slip bore on both sides. And I need 1 like this, which has a slip bore on one side and a threaded bore on the other. This threaded bore is where we will screw in our float valve later. While we're at it, I would also like to install a fail-safe mechanism that's within easy reach in case of emergency. This will allow me to shut off the water supply going up the tank so I can take my sweet time fixing or replacing the valve without having to shut off our main water valve. Otherwise, every family member down to the fish and pigeons will be breathing down my neck, pressuring me to finish up and end the water interruption. For this one, I'll have to cut this PVC pipe stem here so I can insert a PVC ball valve. This type has a double slip hole with a half-inch bore, which should fit perfectly to the old half-inch PVC pipe stem. It has a lever designed to turn only a quarter of a circle, clockwise to close and counterclockwise to open. There's no risk of over-tightening and no rubber washers or gaskets to worry about that may become brittle over time and cause leaks. We'll also need a hacksaw to cut the PVC pipes, PVC cement to connect our new pieces together, and thread seal tape or Teflon tape to waterproof our float valve connection. Oh, and some sandpaper too, about 120 grit, which is quite rough. Let's do a quick review how water travels within this pipeline. From the main line, water goes up along this pipe stem, and we turn on this faucet every time we need to replenish the tank. At the bottom of the tank is a shutoff valve that we turn on whenever we need to use water from this tank. Water drops down and flows back through the main line, like this one here that I just recently fixed, which goes to a bathroom at the back of the house. And with that, we can make our first cut. Ho, hit the brakes! Let's turn off the main water valve first and make sure the tank's valve is off too. Good. Now, with this cut, we accomplish 2 things. 1. we prepare the section where we'll insert our PVC ball valve, and two, we bring down the faucet and old elbow joints attached to this stem, which we will cut off later. Let's go ahead and sand this tip to remove the plastic shavings and clean it too. Then, with a cloth or brush, apply a liberal amount of PVC pipe cement an inch around the tip and in one of the ball valve's slip holes. This is not a check valve, so no need to worry about which side to use. There's no wrong side here, either side is fine. Now, plug in the ball valve onto the PVC pipe with a twisting motion. Just make sure that you end up facing the ball valve's handle towards an accessible angle before the cement dries off. Also, let's wipe off any excess cement. Let me also cut off this rusty wire that used to hold the stem. I have an upgrade for you later. Meantime, let's measure how much PVC pipe we need from the tip of the ball valve to the brim of the tank. And when I compare the measurement against this PVC pipe stem we cut off earlier, we have more than enough. Perfect! I don't need to buy a brand new PVC pipe. I can just reuse this old one, which by the way, still has this old faucet along with the old elbow joints attached on one end. So, I make my second cut here to retake as much length as I could from this old pipe. Then, after measuring and marking what I need for the length of the stem that will connect from the ball valve to the tank's brim, I do my second cut here. Let's put this longer piece aside, and with our remaining shorter piece, I make my third and final cut in the middle. I need these two shorter pieces to connect our three PVC elbow joints later. While we're here, let's sand everything smooth and nice, starting with this longer PVC piece. Make sure that we sand all the plastic shavings off from the outer and inner wall, and do the same to the other end. Then we sand these smaller pieces too on both ends. And let's move to another area where we prepare and dry fit these two short pieces with our PVC elbow joints and our float valve. Looks good. Let's then take our float valve and the elbow joint with a threaded bore on one side. Our float valve is actually designed to be mounted through a hole on the side of a tank. This is why it comes with a black rubber washer and a flange nut. But with my setup, they are not necessary. However, I decided to retain them to form an extra seal when the washer is pressed against the tip of the elbow joint. I just need to figure out the exact distance it should sit from the edge of the thread before wrapping Teflon tape. As always, we wrap tape in a clockwise direction. My first attempt to join the two didn't pan out since I still felt a slight gap in the threads. So, I wrapped a few more Teflon tape. Then I screw in the valve and elbow joint together. The goal here is to get to the tightest turn where the valve spout is pointing downwards and the other end of the elbow joint is pointing upwards. We can now see that the washer and the tip of the elbow joint is flushed. Fantastic! Now, let's connect the short PVC pipes with the rest of the elbow joints with PVC pipe cement. And after all the pieces are assembled together, they should form this shape. To complete our contraption, let's cement our long PVC pipe stem to this last elbow joint. Then we move back to our tank and do a quick dry fit. If the stem is too long, we can easily saw off a small section at the bottom. But I'm already happy how the curve on top is suspended just right a little above the brim. Now, with pipe cement applied to the stem, we permanently connect everything to the PVC ball valve. Awesome! Then let's reinforce the stem against the tank's leg with some zip ties. Wrapping a couple above and below the ball valve since this is where movement will mostly happen whenever we turn the valve on and off. Here comes the best part, seeing how everything works together. I already turned on our main water valve outside, so let's make sure water is coming in through this faucet. Good. Then let's turn our ball valve to the on position. Oh wow. Can you already hear water coming into the tank? Let's look. Part of me is expecting the float valve fell off, But even if it did, I'm not too worried since we've installed a failsafe. Remember? The ball valve. What do you know? It actually works! Of course, the ultimate test here is seeing this float valve completely stop the inflow when it has risen enough, ideally up to this mark right here. Off camera, I already adjusted the float valve's pivot point to an angle that I estimated would sync perfectly with this water level indicator system I built from a previous video. If you want to learn the steps how I made it, check out the info card on the upper right of this video, or if you don't see it, you can also try the link in the description below. In the meantime, let's check for leaks. Starting with our ball valve connection. Looks super dry to me. Good. Let's move up to the elbow joints. All dry as a bone. And when the float valve completely stops the water, we'll take a close look and check its connection to the elbow joint for leaks too. Let's speed this up. By the way, float valves are not as uncommon as you think. They do come in many sizes, forms, and shapes for different applications. They are used in aquariums, fish ponds, and even in your toilet tanks, where they are also known as fill valves or ball float valves. Regardless, they all have one essential job. Automatically allow water to come in and stop it from rising further once a set level is reached. Without going into details, basically you'll need bigger ball floats for higher water pressure. But since our water pressure is lousy, I don't really need a big one. What I was after though was this flatter shape instead of a ball because I needed it not to protrude beyond the brim when the tank is full. Again, this is in preparation for a related water tank lid or cover project I mentioned earlier. Meanwhile, if you're interested to get a float valve yourself, check out the resources section in the description below. And talk about precision. The float valve automatically and completely stops water coming in at the exact level as our mark. And I don't see any leak at the elbow joint and the valve itself. Perfect! Now that we have an automatic float valve and a water tank level indicator installed, we'll no longer need to climb up and down this ladder for a very, very long time. Did you find this video helpful? Give it a thumbs up! If you haven't already, consider subscribing and hitting the bell notification icon so you don't miss out on more videos like this. Subscribing is completely free. Meantime, watch these other videos on the right or in the description below. This is HanDIYman 007. Thanks for watching.